The intrigues are all part and parcel of the politics of the time. The difficulty, however, here is that you're dealing with issues of life and death, not just issues of power or committees or who's in charge of what or control. So the difference, it could lead to fatal consequences.
The King's troops are ready, gentlemen, and I fear for anyone who hasn't sworn allegiance to him. If you do not swear allegiance, I cannot guarantee the safety of your people.
The Achalada meeting marked the beginning of a catastrophic chain of events that would unfold over the following 10 months. But no one ever thought the outcome would be quite so horrendous. 2 messengers were immediately sent to France to inform the exiled King James of both treaties agreed at Achalada Castle. The clock was now ticking, and the chiefs had until the 31st of December to hear from King James before swearing allegiance to King William.
I think they're quite clear they're not going to fight the new regime at this point, but it's going to look so much better if they say, but we'll only do this if we can get agreement from James. It's all about reputation, very, very important. This is a shame on our society, and these people pose all the time.
One of the most reluctant clan chiefs to sign William's treaty was Alistair MacIan, chief of the Glencoe MacDonalds. He was married to a MacDonald from the neighbouring Keppoch region, and they had 2 sons, John and Alistair, 2 heirs born to inherit their father's rank. The eldest son, John, was married to a MacDonald from Glencoe. But surprisingly, the youngest son, Alistair, married a Campbell, related to Robert Campbell of Glenlyon, the Campbell who would one day lead the troops into Glencoe to slaughter them. The many small streams from the north to the south of Glencoe create the River Coe and lend the name the Weeping Glen. Running east to west along the northern border of Argyll, the glen represents a deep scar stretching for 8 miles in length. Both a fortress and a trap, because the only openings are at either end. Living along the river enduring the harsh climate, the MacDonalds lived for 400 years.
The MacIans of Glencoe, along with the MacDonalds of Keppoch and the MacGregors, were the 3 clans that still practiced cattle stealing as a large-scale enterprise. Again, they had no security. Most other clans had titles to their land. They didn't. They had a long tradition of banditry. And that's how often they subsisted. Part of Glencoe is still nowadays called the Lost Valley. It was actually a genuine place where they used to hid the cattle they stole. The landlord technically was the House of Argyll, the chiefs of the Campbells. And when the MacDonalds committed any depredation, it was the Campbell chiefs who had to pay for it. So in this case, the MacDonalds could happily rob and steal. And under Scots law, the landlord, i.e. Clan Campbell chief, had to pay for it.
Until the last few years of the 15th century, the Clan Donald had boasted an impressive holding in Scotland. Called the Lordship of the Isles, it stretched from Antrim in Northern Ireland to Dingwall on the northeast mainland. It was described as a state within a state. But by the end of the 15th century, the then Scottish King, James IV, repeatedly challenged the power of the MacDonalds. The long decline of the MacDonalds, the Lords of the Isles, had begun.
The MacDonalds had been the great power from the 13th, 14th century in Scotland, and then by the 17th century, they were just bit players. They were being reduced, and so they had all this pride and heritage, but not much else. Whereas the Campbells were successful. And MacDonalds, if you like, had the best poets, the best publicists. The Campbells have always had a particularly bad press because they were successful. And almost like success and Highland are not supposed to go together in the eyes of MacDonald poets.
The Crown may have destroyed the Lordship of the Isles, but it still has this problem. How does it enforce its will in the West? And so they find a new set of allies. They outsource the problem. And one of the major houses they outsource it to is Clan Campbell.
And the Campbells, and of course they benefited by being rewarded for their work, and in many cases by being given land, which had previously belonged to the Clan Donald.
So the Campbells get the job of enforcing royal policy. And that means the king in Edinburgh can rather wash his hands of things. You know, our men in those parts are taking care of it.
With John Campbell, the Earl of Breadalbin, in a position of authority between the Highlanders and the throne, King William sent through his official proclamation in August 1691, 2 months after the clan chiefs' meeting at Achalarda Castle. The document clearly outlined that those who did not sign allegiance to King William and his wife by the 31st of December 1691 were to suffer the utmost extremity of the law. But being staunch Jacobites, the Highland clansmen held off from signing as they waited to hear from James in France.
The clan chiefs had some reason to think they might be getting good news from France. It had been a good year for Louis XIV. He had been doing very well against William, so there was always some hope that there was going to be men, money and guns coming from France. France is a superpower.
Their allegiance was partly romantic in a way, but it did lie with the hope that they would be allowed to reassert their power and authority, and that they would get back on even terms with the more powerful clans like the Campbells.
So there are reasons why people wait and wait and wait to hear from James. One is loyalty. He's their king, he's their commander. But there's also, well, there is some reason to hope that there may be good news coming from France.
Then in September 1691, rumours began to spread throughout the Highland clans that a planned invasion by Louis XIV was imminent, giving the Highland chiefs further reason to hold off from taking King William's oath. Pressure was mounting on Breadalbin's shoulders. William wanted to know why the Highlanders had not taken the oath, despite being told of the treaty 3 months earlier. So the king turned to his Secretary of State for Scotland, Sir John Dalrymple, the Master of Stair, to take control of the situation.
He was a difficult man to read, apparently a very calm, expressionless man, somebody who kept himself and his thoughts very much to himself.
If you go back into the 1670s, the early 1680s, he's acting for a Catholic king. He's becomes one of James's favourites in Scotland.
And when William took the throne, he moved smoothly to his side, was appointed Joint Secretary of State for Scotland.
William had no desire to get rid of the servants of James VII in Scotland. William did not come to destroy monarchy, he came to save it from a very stupid king, and he was extremely anxious to keep the best of his servants in post.
To give Dalrymple credit, he is trying to do what his king wants him to do. He's trying to pacify the Highlands, he's trying to free up troops out of the Highlands to send over to the war in Flanders, and he's pursuing that by the means that he feels are necessary.
And he's wanted to demonstrate to William he's the hard man of Scottish politics. Some have argued this was to pave the way for union. I think that's a very incidental issue. He wanted to demonstrate that Scotland can be controlled if union followed good and well. But Scotland can be controlled by London, and he's the man to control it for them.